Calorama, a Recorded Books Highbridge imprint, presents After the End of History, Conversations with Francis Fukuyama. Edited by Mathilde Fasting with Francis Fukuyama. Read by David Shih. Editor's Preface. I would not have thought it necessary to defend democracy and its underlying values in 2021. More than 30 years after the fall of the Berlin Wall. Although the decades after World War II saw many conflicts, such as the Vietnam War and the Balkan conflicts of the 1990s, the period has largely been characterized by peace and prosperity, and a globalization that has brought millions of people out of poverty. In light of these developments, it was hard to imagine that recession, military expansion, social unrest, and fear would once again dominate global politics. In the last few years, however, post-war optimism has been turned on its head. Whether we have reason to fear where this is going, or whether current authoritarian tendencies and nationalistic protectionism will turn out to be fleeting phenomena, depends on the strength of our democracies. Are they capable of handling the challenges they currently face? And, if not, how can we make them more resilient? One thing seems certain. In a world where an increasing number of political tasks require complex and often internationally coordinated responses, the last thing we need is nationalist protectionism and weak democracies. One of the thinkers currently grappling with these questions is the political scientist Francis Fukuyama. Many know Fukuyama as the person who proclaimed liberal democracy's victory after the fall of the wall to mark the end of history. In 2019, it was 30 years since the essay, The End of History, was published in the small journal, The National Interest. The book, The End of History and the Last Man, followed a few years later, in 1992, sealing Fukuyama's fame. The end of history term will, it seems, forever be tied to his name. Few public intellectuals have been more influential and prolific than Fukuyama. There was no end of history for him. He has kept on writing for more than 30 years, presenting deep insights into the workings of political order, its perils and challenges, and the importance of institutions for well-functioning states. His alternative approach to human cooperation evolved slowly in his mind and in his work until it found its final expression in The Origins of Political Order, From Pre-Human Times to the French Revolution, in 2011. This bioanthropological approach breaks with classical liberal theory and shines an explanatory light on the problems and decay of some contemporary democracies. Fukuyama has observed weaknesses in Western political development for a long time, especially since the financial crisis in 2008. In Political Order and Political Decay, From the Industrial Revolution to the Globalization of Democracy, 2014, he points out that several conditions represent threats to the functioning of liberal democracy. He expands on his worries in Identity, Contemporary Identity Politics and the Struggle for Recognition, 2018, expressing a deep concern for the current growth of populist movements and more authoritarian political leaders in the United States and across the West more generally. His life's work reveals what we need to address the contemporary issues of populist leaders, poor understanding of democracy's underpinnings, and rapid technological change. Further, he strongly argues for the importance of having a well-functioning government when crisis hits. The idea of this project was originally born almost 10 years ago. My first encounter with Fukuyama was through his book, The Origins of Political Order. What caught my interest was his explanation of the historical roots of liberal democracy. Being Norwegian, I asked myself why an American political thinker showed such interest in Scandinavia and Denmark in particular. Which part of these countries' histories made Fukuyama point to them as ideals of political order? When I read Political Order and Political Decay, 3 years later, it struck me how fragile the balance of power and institutions in liberal democracies are. My first idea was to explain his thought to a Norwegian audience and relate his ideas specifically to challenges facing Norwegian society. However, after meeting and talking to Fukuyama in 2018, the idea of a dialogue emerged as the best way to express Fukuyama's important insights, in a way that could also highlight the scope and variety of his work over more than three decades. A key element in Fukuyama's thought is found in Plato's dialogues, and so the dialogue seems especially appropriate when trying to explore the richness of Fukuyama's many books and articles. My hope is that through this dialogue, Fukuyama will emerge as an engaged conversation partner for the listener and not a distant intellectual political thinker. After I first met Fukuyama in Oslo in 2018, I was fortunate to get the chance to read the manuscript of Identity. This made it clear to me how consistently he has pursued the idea of recognition that first appeared in The End of History. A year later, over a few days in March 2019, I met with Fukuyama to interview him about his ideas in more detail. We met in his office at Stanford, among all his books. In February 2020, we met again over 3 days in Oslo. During this time, we had the opportunity to elaborate on observations Fukuyama had made in his many talks and discussions after the publication of his book, Identity, and in commemoration of the 30th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall in November 2019. The interviews, as they appear in this book, have been edited for the sake of clarity and to eliminate some repetition. 1. What has happened after the end of history? In the current political context, there are many dark clouds. The question is whether liberal democracies will prove themselves capable in rainy days. The 2016 election of Donald Trump, Brexit, and the rise of populism in Europe are contributing to a more unstable and uncertain future. And the rise of China is altering the global balance of power. How does this influence liberal democracies? Liberal democracies are taken for granted. We have in the West been taking liberal democracy more or less for granted for the past 50 years. What has happened after the end of history? Why do we need this conversation now? I think you are right. In the United States, nobody has really felt threatened. The basic constitutional system has worked for a very long time. Richard Nixon challenged it, and that led to his resignation and the whole Watergate scandal. But in a sense, I don't think that the threat he posed to the system was nearly as great as the one that Donald Trump poses. Nixon never openly tried to undermine his own Justice Department or the FBI. He denied that he was guilty of the things that he was accused of. He lied about things, but he didn't say the whole effort to hold the president accountable was a big hoax or a big fraud. With Trump, it is different. And I think that this kind of disrespect for legal and constitutional institutions is really spreading to too many parts of the world. He likes to attack existing institutions, and I think this is a very dangerous tendency. In your books about political order, you have talked about the miracle of modern liberal democracy, in which strong states capable of enforcing law are nonetheless checked by law and by legislatures, finding a balance of power that made no one dominant and forcing all to compromise. People living in liberal democracies will have a sense of what they are, but it is useful to repeat and clarify. Let us start by defining liberal democracies. What are they? Well, in my view, a liberal democracy is three separate institutions. One of them is a modern state, meaning a state that is capable of actually delivering services and protecting the country, both internally and externally. The second institution is a rule of law that limits the power of the state so that the state only behaves lawfully according to rules that are agreed upon by the community. The third set of institutions are the ones of democratic accountability that make sure that the state reflects the interests of the whole people. Ultimately, an important part of liberal democracy is a combination of liberal institutions that limit power and treat citizens fairly, and democratic ones that respond to the will of the population. Those two are not necessarily aligned with one another. The other thing that's very difficult to achieve is balance, because, on the one hand, you want a state that is strong enough to be able to actually do things, to enforce laws and arrest criminals and so forth. But on the other hand, you don't want it to be so strong that it violates the rights of its citizens. And somehow, you have to have both a strong state that can constrain and at the same time let people lead their lives. This balance is important. You are preoccupied with the value of the modern state. Why? Liberal democracies are also modern states capable of delivering services, rules of law that limit the power of the state, and democratically accountable institutions. Of those, democracy is the easiest to achieve. It is not that difficult to hold elections and get a sense of what the people want. A modern impersonal state and the rule of law are much more difficult to create. What I think is incredibly common all over the world is a state that delivers services only to people who are supporters of a particular political leader. In other words, the state is not impersonal. It's full of patronage, and corruption sometimes reaches grotesque levels. Sometimes it's captured by military gangs, by families, or by other people, and the state simply ceases functioning. The state is becoming personal instead of being impersonal. I think the impersonality part is really difficult to achieve. A modern state does not treat individuals differently, depending on whether you're a friend of the ruler or a relative or something of that sort. Impersonality is something that many countries fail to achieve. This is the argument I tried to make in my two books about political order, that it's hard to achieve because it's not very natural. Your natural instinct is to favor your friends and family, so it's not surprising that corruption keeps coming back. That's why I think that the modern state is fragile. It is a miracle, and it is fragile. Why is it a miracle? I think that a modern democracy is a balancing act. On the one hand, you have to have a state. A state is all about power. It's an institution that aggregates and concentrates power and allows the state to enforce laws to defend the community against outsiders, to police behavior on the inside. But once you create this powerful state, you need to constrain it. And we do that through the rule of law and also through democracy, which makes the state obedient to the wishes of at least a good proportion of the population. Having that balance is something that's very hard to achieve. Some societies suffer from having no state or a weak state, and others suffer from having an excessively strong state. To get that balance, I do think, is a bit of a political miracle, because we are usually preferring to be friends with our friends, and then not so good friends with people further away from us. If we keep it on this philosophical level, John Stuart Mill argued that there is an inherent controversy in liberalism between freedom and equality. When freedom increases in society, equality diminishes. You have written the following: the major arguments concern not the principles of liberal society, but the precise point at which the proper trade-off between liberty and equality should come. Is this true, or does freedom also enhance equality? I think it is a trade-off, which a lot of people don't want to accept. If you have more liberty, the fact that people have different resources and that they are born with different talents and social endowments means they're not going to end up equal in terms of outcomes. Some people are going to be rich, and some people are not going to succeed. And I think that in order to correct that and equalize outcomes, you need to restrict people's liberty. We've been bouncing back and forth for the last several decades between free markets and attempts to deregulate the market, and the imposition of redistributive policies to make outcomes more equal. But more redistributive policies create a need for a strong state, which in turn restricts people's liberties. And then, we react against that restriction. And so we go back to liberalizing everything to increase individual freedom again. It's kind of a pendulum? Yes. We don't ever seem to be able to get to a point of stability where we have the right trade-off. Right now, I think that we're paying for the excesses of liberty from the 1980s and 90s. This period began with U.S. President Ronald Reagan and British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher in the 1980s, when they said the state has gotten too big, and it's in the way of economic growth. We liberalized things, including all these banks, which then led to the financial crisis and to greater inequality. It's hard to know when to stop. Now, with the COVID-19 crisis, we're moving rapidly in the other direction, towards stronger executive authority and more restrictions on individual freedom. It's hard not to overshoot on these pendulum swings, because once the political pressure builds to move in the opposite direction, politicians seek to outbid one another in how far and fast to move. A basic question I want to ask is about your important and somewhat new contributions to political theory, especially to democratic theory. You seem to criticize the old liberal contract theories and replace them with your own sociobiological anchored argument based on a theory of human nature. Is the social human being the basis for your understanding of democracies? Well, I think that it's not such a new approach. A lot of liberal theory is based on an economic view of human beings, where you have isolated individuals who have their own preferences and their reason. Essentially, society is just an aggregation of all these individuals. In Europe, this theory never caught on to the extent that it did in the Anglo-Saxon world, but it certainly dominated a lot of American social science thinking about how politics works. I think that's not a correct view of human nature. I believe that there is an innate social side of human behavior that's reflected in, for example, the importance people attach to social recognition. They want other people to recognize a kind of inner worth that they have, and they get very angry if that doesn't happen. This desire for recognition explains a lot of modern politics. In that sense, yes, I ground my view of political behavior in a different view of human nature. The number of democracies has declined. Freedom House annually reports the number of democracies in the world. This number increased substantially since World War II, up until 2005. Since then, the numbers have slightly decreased. The 2019 Freedom House Index shows 87 countries classified as free. And the Freedom of the World report stated that 2019 was the 13th consecutive year of decline in global freedom. When Fukuyama published The End of History and The Last Man, just after the end of the Cold War, optimism and the number of democracies were peaking. The key to freedom was democracy. We are talking about liberal democracies, a term that consists of two words, liberal and democracy. How would you best describe a modern understanding of democracy? There are a couple of ways of approaching that question. A lot of political scientists just give it a procedural definition. They say that democracy has to be free and to have fair, periodic, multi-party elections. That's one way of thinking about it. But you can also think about democracy in substantive terms. Not just these procedures, but whether the outcomes actually reflect the will of the people. That's where a lot of modern democracies run into trouble, because even though you have formally correct procedures, you still don't get to outcomes that people like very much. Why that's the case varies from country to country, but that's one of the problems right now. Then people are blaming democracy for not being what they thought it was, and, well, sometimes they're right. Sometimes elites can game the system in such a way that they really make the system not responsive to the people's true wishes. And that's the problem with lobbying and big interest groups and this sort of thing. Are you worried? In terms of global democracy, things obviously look much more pessimistic today than they did 30 years ago in November 1989. We were in the middle of what Samuel Huntington, the great political scientist, labeled the third wave of democratization. The number of democracies increased around the world from about 35 in the year 1972 to over 110 or 115 by the early 2000s. And 1989 was right in the middle of that process. I wrote my essay, The End of History, shortly before the fall of the Berlin Wall. It came out in the summer of 1989. Obviously, that event marked a big jump in the number of democracies as former communist states of Eastern Europe democratized and the former Soviet Union collapsed. Since the mid-2000s, we are in what my colleague Larry Diamond calls a democratic recession. There's been a decline in the number of democracies. Russia and China are now consolidated authoritarian states that are projecting their influence around the world. And you've had the rise of populist movements within established democracies. Populism is perhaps the biggest surprise in this period and has harmed the quality of democracy even in the most established democratic countries, including the United States and Britain. Is what we are witnessing temporary counterwaves, to quote Samuel Huntington, or are they fundamental reversals that belie the optimism before the millennium? I don't think you can answer that at this point. My hope and my suspicion are that they're not permanent, that this doesn't represent the permanent undermining of democracy. But how far it's going to go before it exhausts itself is very hard to say. I have recently read a very gloomy book that said that what happened after 1989 was not the end of history, but the light that failed. The authors show why liberal democracy in Poland, Hungary, and Russia took a different path after 1989. What are your thoughts about this?
I think that Ivan Krushtev and Steve Holmes have a very interesting thesis, which could well be correct. Liberalism, as opposed to democracy, never really took root in Eastern Europe. In Poland, you had an initial elite that was very oriented toward Europe and toward the West. This elite dominated the politics of the first decade after the fall of the Berlin Wall. But there were populist forces that never really accepted the liberal part of liberal democracy. They wanted democratic elections and majority rule, but they didn't accept the idea that a modern society needed to tolerate diversity and that it needed to respect the rule of law. What you're seeing now, after 30 years, is the erosion of those institutions. Krushtev and Holmes also speak about the ongoing demographic crisis in Eastern Europe, which I think has not been adequately recognized. Essentially, a large part of Eastern Europe has emptied out into Western Europe as people seek better opportunities, jobs, and so forth. And that's led to this sense of crisis, both for Hungary and Poland, and other countries in that region. The authors also mention Russia, saying that it took a different path. Putin's game is to mock liberal democracy. He is holding up a mirror and saying, "What I'm doing to you is just what you're doing to us." The authors claim that the Russians never believed in liberal democracy. They were just forging and faking it, pretending for a while. Russia's ultimate goal is not conversion or assimilation, but revenge and vindication. Is this a valid assumption? Russia has been trying to find a role for itself, not as part of the West, but as an alternative. I don't think that Putin has fully elaborated what that position is. He's tried a lot of different ideas over the years. He's had this idea of sovereign democracy in the 1990s, and that evolved into a sponsorship for basically all the populist movements where he can claim leadership of a kind of social conservatism that is allegedly based on Christian values and the family. Whether this is really honest on his part is hard to say, because, for example, opposition to abortion, which is important to most Christian groups in Western countries, is really not an issue in Putin's Russia. That being said, he's now found a place as leading an international alliance of populist organizations, including many in the United States. That's a very different configuration of world politics. This is truly gloomy, but you have recently said that the big question is whether there can be long-term historical progress. You said that you remain optimistic about this. Do you think you will be able to defend this position?
Yes. There are a lot of reasons why democracy is a better system and functions better. It really does provide prosperity, and it also provides accountability
And people want those things. And so even if other systems can override some of the constraints democracy imposes, in the long run, these constraints are there for a reason. There's lots of options, but you may not be sure if they're as good as liberal democracy. Liberal democracy is thriving in some parts of the world, even if we get another impression here in Europe. We may probably divide this into two different types of democracies: emerging democracies and old established democracies, like the European version of democracy. Larry Diamond, a Stanford colleague of yours, says in his book, Ill Winds, that he has concerns, but he is also optimistic. Do you share his views? Are there good reasons to be optimistic if you're looking at the world picture of democracies? The world picture is very mixed. There are very hopeful signs in a certain sense. Prior to the COVID-19 crisis, the world had never looked better because you've had economic growth, hundreds of millions of people lifted out of poverty in developing countries, and by and large, you have stability in many parts of the world. In terms of democracies, you've seen a clear rejection of authoritarian government in many countries. You see this in the protests against Nicolas Maduro in Venezuela, against Daniel Ortega in Nicaragua, in Armenia, in Sudan, in Ethiopia, in Belarus, and in Algeria. All of these countries have lived under pretty brutal dictatorships, and there's a clear rejection by civil society in those countries. The problem we've had over the years is that when you move from protest against an authoritarian government that's widely disliked to actually establishing democratic institutions, this is a very difficult transition for many countries to make. But I think the impulse that we saw in 1989 in Eastern Europe is still alive in many other parts of the world. We've seen a remarkable revival of protest after the killing of George Floyd in May 2020, not just in the United States, but in many other parts of the world. These protests are driven by young people who have distinct political views. Rising populism uses democratic legitimacy to undermine liberal institutions. We will have plenty of time to cover the illnesses of mature democracies, but as you say, there's hope. If we look at your work, you have been associated in your youth with what was called the neoconservatives, and you broke with them after the invasion of Iraq. And you also did not like the economic policies that finally led to the financial crisis. What were your main concerns? The first was about American power and how it could be used to democratize the world. And the second was this idea that markets were self-regulating and that you didn't need a state to watch over them. I think the disasters that followed both of these events showed that these ideas really needed to be rethought. Also, the increasing liberalization of the global economy resulted in a huge increase in actual inequality in the United States and in Britain, the two countries that led this liberal revolution. It was becoming clear that this level of inequality was not sustainable, that there would be some kind of a social revolution if things weren't getting better across the board for ordinary people as well. At the same time, the Republican Party was moving to the right in a way that I really didn't like at all. After Barack Obama's election, quite frankly, the fact that we elected a black man president really drove a lot of conservatives crazy. And they started to get more and more extreme in their opposition to Obama, like in the debate over Obama's healthcare initiative, which I just thought was completely crazy. The United States is the only rich country that doesn't have a universal healthcare system, 70 years after the rest of Europe had put this in place. And the Republicans say this is socialism and un-American. When I read your publications, I don't see you as a deeply conservative person. I see you more in line with what I would say would be a European classical liberal. I think that I accept what you're saying. You don't have to tell me what you voted for, because that doesn't matter. I'm happy to tell you who I voted for. I voted twice for Obama, and I voted for Hillary Clinton. I voted for the Democratic candidate, Joe Biden, in 2020. The 2016 election made it clear that liberal democracies face several challenges. In my view, there is one external and two internal threats currently facing liberal democracies. the external threat is authoritarian success, competing political order. The first of the internal threats is the erosion or even destruction of institutions, especially those guaranteeing the rule of law. The second internal threat is the lack of mutual respect, losing faith in liberal democracies. This challenge is more subtle as it concerns the destruction of the conditions for recognition and loss of faith in liberal democracies. It can also imply the destruction of possibilities for criticism and possibilities of finding viable political solutions. Do you agree with this classification? I would put it a little bit differently. I think the third threat is a particular kind of populism that has arisen in a lot of democracies and that basically uses democratic legitimacy to undermine liberal institutions. After the publication of Identity and the 30th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall, Fukuyama has been thinking through social and political changes since he wrote his famous essay. We will explore them in the next chapters. 2. How have world politics changed? An important shift in politics has taken place during the last decades. Identity politics has become more pronounced, and political parties that emphasize identity attract voters to a greater extent than political parties that formed the earlier left-right economic policy axis. Globalization has helped many countries, but has also created greater economic inequality in the Western world. Fukuyama was asked by the Journal of Democracy to reflect on the 30 years since the Berlin Wall crumbled. This resulted in an article titled, 30 Years of World Politics, What Has Changed? In this article, Fukuyama outlines six underlying trends that have changed world politics. A reorientation of the political axis from economics to identity. A technology shift from being democratic to becoming Big Brother. A loss of status for mediating institutions and the press. A decline in trust. The consequences of neoliberalism. And the ramifications of U.S. policy mistakes. We have touched on some of these already, and will be returning to many of these trends during our conversation. But we start by looking at the broader picture of world politics. The axis has shifted to identity politics. In the 20th century, we had the left and the right in politics. Fukuyama argues that this axis has now shifted to an axis of identity. His book, Identity, was a reaction to populism, and he argues that identity is a main driver of current political developments. Identity politics is not new, but its current political expression, and the polarization it leads to, is. Can you explain what you mean with this shift in politics from 1989? The fundamental shift is the global axis of world politics, moving from being defined by a left and a right by economic ideology. That image of left and right was largely the nature of politics in the 20th century. You have a left that wanted redistribution through a powerful government that could tax and provide social benefits to the people. And you had a right that was interested in free markets, individual freedom, and a more limited state. The world that I grew up in was defined by this polarity. And what has changed? We are increasingly now in a world that is defined by an axis of identity. The world defined by identity is perhaps best summed up by President Donald Trump, who in the midterm elections in the United States back in 2018 could have campaigned on traditional Republican policies like tax cuts, the fact that the economy was producing jobs, or economic growth. But instead, he did not talk about that. What did he talk about? He talked about an army of immigrant invaders that were coming up from Mexico, crossing the southern border, and he talked about sending troops. To meet this supposed threat, he was threatening to take away birthright citizenship, and he essentially said that the country was under attack by foreigners. This is a major shift in the nature of American conservatism away from the free market ideology that defined the conservatism of Ronald Reagan. This is the shift from an economic axis to an identity axis. It's not limited to the United States, although I think we all became aware of this as a political trend in 2016, when Donald Trump was elected and when the British voted to leave the European Union. It is appearing in many different places. In Europe, you are very much aware because you have two members of the European Union, Hungary and Poland, that have shifted very heavily in this populist direction. Hungary is probably the clearest case, under Viktor Orban's Fidesz party. All of this is actually not a problem for democracy, but for liberal democracy, because the tendency of these populist leaders is to say, I won the election, so I have legitimacy, and they proceed to undermine rule of law institutions. Do you see this shift elsewhere in the world? Further afield, you have India under Prime Minister Narendra Modi. India was established in the late 1940s as a liberal state. India is an unbelievably diverse country, by religion, by region, and by language. The only way you can run a country that's so diverse and complex is through a liberal system of laws and rules. India had a liberal national identity that was the inheritance from Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru. But Mr. Modi has been trying to shift that identity away from that idea of a liberal India to one based on Hindu nationalism, which the founders had explicitly rejected. The consequences are things like the citizenship law that the Bharatiya Janata Party passed last year. This made it much harder to become an Indian citizen if you happen to be Muslim. That means the exclusion of up to 200 million Indian citizens who are Muslim. This is going on in many different parts of the world. I can see this in the kind of militant Buddhism that has arisen in Sri Lanka and Myanmar. You can see it in Latin America, where traditional populism has been left-wing, but where we have an example of a right-wing populist, Jair Bolsonaro, who was elected president of Brazil in 2018. Latin America is a region that typically has left-wing populists like Hugo Chavez. But for the first time, you have a right-wing populist who actually much more explicitly than Donald Trump talks in racist terms about black Brazilians. How has this displayed itself in the United States? You have to look at the demographics of the way people vote. The left-wing party's biggest single base was the working class. The Democrats counted on white working-class voters to win elections. The New Deal coalition continued up to Ronald Reagan, but then motivations shifted, partly due to the way that the Democratic Party has shifted on racial issues toward civil rights, feminism, and so forth. This change started to turn off some of those white working-class voters, and that process has continued. The left began to redefine itself and was more preoccupied with injustices being done to specific groups of people rather than the working class itself. For many people on the left, the working class became part of the problem. Over time, a lot of left-wing parties, both in the United States and in Europe, began to lose support of working-class white voters. A lot of white nationalists will say, "We white people are now a victimized minority. We have been mistreated by affirmative action programs. We can't get our children to the right kinds of schools because the left favors foreigners over us." This has led to a pretty poisonous kind of politics. Further, a lot of working-class people are quite culturally conservative. It has to do with race because, before the 1960s, the Democratic Party was built around a big coalition of very disparate groups. They consisted of trade unions, of intellectuals and progressives in the North, but also Southern racists who were a big part of the party during the 1930s when Franklin Roosevelt was president. Then, beginning in the 1960s, the Democratic Party broke on race and embraced civil rights legislation. The party tied itself to civil rights, and this change led to the migration of Southern racists to the Republican Party. This is actually the shift from economic self-interest to politics based on identity? Yes. I believe there is a tendency to want to identify with people who are like you. You may have heard of this famous Stanford study that took place back in the 1950s. They took these two very homogeneous groups of adolescent boys and divided them into two teams and said, "You're on the red team and you're on the blue team." the red team had these characteristics that were completely made up. And by the end of the study, they were all trying to kill each other because there's just this tendency to want to identify with someone like yourself. It doesn't have to be by race or ethnicity. It could be by any distinguishing characteristic. I think a lot of people are trying to wrestle with this. And a lot of the polarization in our politics is emotional in a way that defies economic rationality. People are voting against their own self-interest. Obamacare was very good for a lot of southern rural voters, but many voted for Republican politicians. Even if they didn't have health insurance, they voted against it. It does not make much sense, but that's what it means when identity overpowers economic self-interest. How do you explain this false consciousness? Why does identity trump economic self-interest? A lot of Republicans are not necessarily very loyal to the Republican Party, but they hate the idea of a Democrat, who for them is a certain kind of person. A feminist, a gay person, a politically correct person. All these different epithets that they don't like. So they'll vote for anybody who identifies as Republican. Modern economics is based on the theory of everyone's rational self-interest, but a lot of social psychology literature tells you this theory isn't true. People start out with certain ideological or cultural commitments, and then they use all of their brain power to justify those positions. Inequality, erosion of trust, and resentment lead to political shift. Globalization has often been blamed for creating inequality. I would like to hear how you explain the rise in inequality. Let me just start with the classic approach for all who took a trade theory course. You would have learned that free trade makes everyone richer in the aggregate. But what the professor should have told you, which some people didn't listen to all that carefully, was that not every individual in every country is better off as a result. Indeed, workers in rich countries are losing jobs and opportunities to similarly skilled workers in developing countries. As China and India developed rising middle classes and pulled people out of poverty, you have stagnation in South Carolina. This resentment among workers in rich countries is obviously part of the explanation for the recent shift in politics, but you have also talked about another slow-moving trend, the decrease of trust. Yes, this populism goes together with a broad erosion of trust in institutions. I wrote a book back in the 1990s called Trust. Trust is intangible and yet critical for the functioning of a society. The idea that you treat other citizens honestly permits free circulation of information. It promotes social cooperation, and by all measures, trust in modern societies has been declining. Trust in labor unions, political parties, churches, corporations, governments, even families. If you look at survey data over the last 50 years, levels of trust in virtually all of these institutions have declined. And this has been going on across many countries over the same period of time as the rise in inequality. Basically, this is what Robert Putnam wrote about in his Bowling Alone book back in the 1990s about the United States. But while the decline of trust is worrisome, it can be seen as the byproduct of good things that have been happening around the world. But is the loss of trust in authorities and more transparency in general only negative? No. This is a complicated phenomenon because part of the reason for this erosion of trust has to do with certain positive developments. For example, over the last 30 years, the levels of education in many countries have been rising, and with higher levels of education, people are more skeptical about authority.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.